This is Bart Parent, who is from Ghent University in Belgium. And we are going to pneumonia, but he's going to talk about inter-rater agreement and diagnostic accuracy of lung auscultation to detect calf pneumonia, which will sort of complement what we heard earlier about and go well with the talk on the whisperer.
Colin, you're sure you don't want to switch talks? But indeed, my subject of today is actually the vet and not the calves or the cattle. We just had a look on how good practitioners are actually in using the stethoscope to diagnose pneumonia. You all know BRD, and you all know that it is actually a summary terminology which has all infections of the respiratory tract in the single term. Being a runny nose up to life-threatening pneumonia, that's actually a bit all of the same in current research. It's the main indication for antimicrobial use, and as you all know, the rules of plays are actually changing a lot. In the past, we could actually use antibiotic coverage to deal with our problems, but in the near future, that's absolutely impossible. And rational antimicrobial use will be one of the key factors for us veterinarians. So in this context, we need absolutely good diagnostic tests. Good diagnostic tests to confirm the need for an antimicrobial, but also to confirm the cases to be treated, to detect the cases which actually have pneumonia. If you talk to physicians about this, rational use, according to them, is actually, yes, you can use antibiotics for bacterial infections in hosts which have trespassed natural defense lines, in susceptible hosts, preventionally, and infections which are unlikely to self-cure. Or when you go with your kid to the physician, he will still use the stethoscope to determine whether the kid needs antibiotics, yes or no, together with CRP. And there's an ongoing debate, as you can see there, in human medicine as well, on how good diagnostic clinical examination is actually to identify pneumonia. So it's not only a veterinary issue. So this is an overview of the work of others on different diagnostic techniques we have. It's just to make a little bit of a sketch up there. So you have the sensitivities and the specificities. And if you first look at our producers, because you want to add value, you want to be better than your producers in doing diagnostics, of course. We only have information about the North American system on the pen checkers in there. And they perform reasonably well with about 65% sensitivity and 65% specificity. So the next step was, of course, using kind of scorecards, which is very good from an epidemiological monitoring point of view. And that typically improved with about 10 to 15% on both factors. Interesting, this is BRD, respiratory infections of the complete tract. If you try to find clinical symptoms which are linked with pneumonia, the story is a bit different. So we have a poster here of our work in veal calves, in which we show that there is very little symptoms which are linked with pneumonia. Only a lowered head, so depression and increased respiratory rate. But of such models, the sensitivity is particularly very low. So yeah, if we then continue, the farmer wants to see you auscultate. That's the way in most countries that, as a vet, you still confirm that there is pneumonia, yes or no. And it's surprisingly how little information is available, actually, on this ancient technique, both in veterinary medicine, but also in humans. So here I have two recent studies. They only involve a single observer, likely not a practitioner, and the results are very variable. For example, you can see that even the sensitivity was about 6% in one of those studies. Another interesting thing is that, yes, we have a reasonably good technique, a kind of a gold standard-like. That's ultrasound. We end up with 80% sensitivity and about 95% specificity, so pretty good as well. And just to get you the picture right, just by chance, flipping a coin is a 50% sensitivity, 50% specificity. If you just Google on veterinary practices, on how they put themselves in the market, the stethoscope is everywhere. You can see it even when promoting herd health, the stethoscope needs to be around the neck somewhere to identify the veterinarian from the farmer. And our symbols, so yes, it's our hallmark, but how good are we in using it? So that was our objective, determining the diagnostic accuracy and the inter-rater agreement between a large group of vets. So for these kind of research things, you go abroad. You go to the Netherlands to perform it. I had the opportunity, because we were giving training sessions on ultrasound with those vets in a veal farm. We performed three sessions on consecutive days, and one of the trials, the eye-opener, was actually to allow them to auscultate some calves to determine their sensitivity and specificity. So how did we work? There was a pen, a pen which had been recently found ill by the farmer and had already been treated. So many of the clinical signs were masked. The participants were allowed to auscultate, but only auscultate those calves. So no clinical examination, no other things. And they were specifically asked to perform as they would do in practice. You all know that practitioners have a lot of work, so there's some speed in all of those acts. So we wanted them to just do as they normally do it. Then they just mentioned us, yes, this is normal or this is abnormal according to me, no details. And abnormal meant, yes, I would advise the farmer to put this animal onto antimicrobials. Afterwards, we used the ultrasound to detect consolidations. So just for the case definitions, for us in this study, we used the 1 centimeter square consolidation somewhere in the lung of those little calves. They are only 14 days old, those calves, during the research then. That was our diagnosis. Then you had pneumonia. It's a very nice technique because you can really visualize things. As you can see here, you have a nice consolidation. Well, this part of the lung is zone 2 here in this calf with the catarrhal pneumonia. So it's nice because you know what you're seeing. So let's go to the results. First of all, the agreement between auscultating and the ultrasound findings. So on average of all those participants, the 49 participants, the kappa value is about 0.38. So that's not high, absolutely not, but it's fair. What was interesting was that there actually was no influence of the session, no influence of the gender of the veterinarian, and also not of the experience of the veterinarian. That's something which is often said by all the veterinarians to their younger colleagues, that experience matters. So then this is the diagnostic accuracy, actually, of the 3 different sessions. And you can immediately have a look on the sensitivity and specificity. And that's tremendously low, as you can see. Only 63%, and specificity only 46%. But what was for me most interesting is the enormous range. You see here 20 to 100 and 0 to 100% for specificity. So actually, we are not dealing with the same veterinarians. There's a very big variance in that. 4% was perfect on both sides. So this is a scatter plot, which actually shows you the combination for every vet of specificity and sensitivity. And just for your explanation, the star is the 65% point where the farmers are, as far as we have any information on how good they are. So every vet who actually performed within this rectangle here on the upper right side, he performed better than the producers. So I would say, well done, guys. You're actually a diagnostic test, so you are a return on investment for your clients. The other half here, with 50%, under the 50% bonus for both factors. The story is a little bit different because my advice to them will actually be try to toss in front of the calf to decide to use the antimicrobial, yes or no. Then we have this group, which is very good for the government because they will likely only treat animals which really need the antimicrobials. They will not use too much. On the other side, we have most vets, of many vets, they lower their sensitivity. They lower their cutoff. They really want to hear something that is wrong, and they actually give antimicrobials quicker. From an animal welfare perspective, that is, of course, a good thing. So if we then look on the fact whether the vets actually agree on the same calves, for the different sessions, we calculate the fly's kappa over there. As you can estimate or have expected, the agreement was very, very, very slight. So that's important, because as a farmer, you can actually, within the same practice, another vet coming by, consequences can be completely different. So just the conclusions, the take-home message. Well, in general, the sensitivity and specificity is very low of lung auscultation, at least in the study population. But don't worry, because what is available in human medicine gives the same message, low. It's a very variable and a very low on average. Sensitivity is higher, so vets really want to hear something. And what was for me very interesting was the low agreement. And it's with many of those subjective methods of diagnostics that the agreement between vets is often very poor. So how are we going to solve this problem? Well, yeah, kind of easy. We can use better techniques and training, more advanced training, and self-checking is a very important thing, in my opinion. We can use alternative techniques, which you have already seen today and the previous day, or we can really move to proven devices which have a higher sensitivity and specificity. But very likely is also an observer effect over there, of course. All studies have limitations. Well, limitations in this study are very obvious, that ultrasound is not a gold standard. You might only see the superficial lesions, the alveolitis, whereas, of course, when you have a bronchitis, there are already changes in the lung sounds. And there's selection bias, because those vets were interested in pulmonary health because they participated. So likely positive, better results than otherwise. And these are results of auscultation. It's not about the clinical skills of the vet, because they were not allowed to perform a complete clinical examination. So actually, we have to be a little bit careful on comparing the results of this, which is on pneumonia, to the other studies, which are actually on the respiratory disease. But in the viewpoint of rational antimicrobial use, it will become increasingly more important to distinguish upper area infections from the pneumonias, which actually do require antimicrobial treatment. So I would like to thank all the antigestic vets for their kind participation and the people who organized all this, and you for your attention, of course. Thank you.
Do we have any questions? I have more of a, we have one, good.
Kate Burnby from the UK. You have pointed out that there was an agenda or age difference in the ability of the vets, but there were some vets that were obviously very, very good. What is your hypothesis on what the differences might have been between those vets?
Between those groups, well, actually, our hypothesis was clearly that older vets with more years of experience would just outperform the younger vets, but that was absolutely not true. And for the gender difference, we did not have a hypothesis, fortunately, beforehand. But there are gender differences in different things. For example, like let's have a look on the fact that female farmers take better care of their calves, for example. So that's why we put it in. And the other effects we had was comparing faculties on their training. That was one of our interests. But in the population, they all came from one faculty. So we cannot say anything about that.
Anyone else? Gosh, is someone who really likes physical examination. It sort of hurts me to see all this, and I think it's a failure of the diagnostician, perhaps more than a failure of the stethoscope, since an electronic stethoscope seems to work pretty well. You mentioned that there are two possible solutions, and one is better training, and one is something that is easier to use, I suppose. But I will say that when I was in private practice for 5 years, I was nearly 100% accurate, because I was the only one who ever listened, and I don't think I ever made a mistake. And I went back to the university, and other people began to listen, and students began to ask questions, and everything got necropsied, and my accuracy dropped dramatically. So I think that probably experience doesn't mean that much, because if I were still in practice almost 40 years later, I'd probably still be 100% accurate if I went about it the same way. That's very interesting and somewhat sobering. Thank you very much for that presentation.
You're welcome.